Good evening. Welcome to ITV News Meridian.
Tonight's headlines here in the South. In Connor's memory, how the lives of young people will be saved because of one family's determination.
From the heat of Iraq, a damp and drizzly royal homecoming for the Rifles' return to Aldershot.
So near and yet so far, Saints players thank fans for their support, but were they cheated of victory at Wembley?
And the not-so-fantastic Mr. Fox, a quick steal in a quiet back garden, caught on video. Good evening. He died after just one punch during a night out with friends. Within hours, Sussex teenager Connor Saunders had saved the lives of five other people through organ donation.
In the days and weeks that followed, his family decided they wanted that legacy of life-saving to continue. And today, a remarkable campaign reached a remarkable milestone, as John Ryle reports.
What's the first silly question you might ask me? Brilliant, I like you a lot.
And the lesson today is how to save a life. The pupils of St Mark's Primary School were this morning drilled in how to save someone from choking, how to place someone in the recovery position. And next, eight school staff will be trained how to use this.
Training mode. Call for help. Remove pads from package in back of unit. Apply.
A defibrillator donated to the school by the Connor Saunders Foundation, the 50th Sussex school to receive one through a campaign launched by Connor's family after his tragic death. The 19-year-old died in hospital from head injuries after being felled by a single punch in a car park at Rottingdean in 2012.
When this first happened, and it will be nearly 5 years ago, I didn't think as a family we'd be able to survive a day without Connor in our lives. To think that we're nearly 5 years on and we're our 50th defib, it truly is amazing.
If you've got one on site, the chances of survival are nearly about 80% now. If they're not on site and you happen to wait for one, the chances of survival are about 5%.
An average of 12 children a week suffer heart emergencies in Britain's schools, yet the vast majority do not have a defibrillator.
The Year 6 children, their writing activity after this is to write a letter to actually request that there should be a defibrillator in every school.
I think it's a very good thing to have in the school because it could save lives like very easily.
Amazing, now I can actually feel safe and all of us can feel safe.
One Sussex MP says classroom defibrillators and staff trained to use them should be the norm, not the exception.
The legislation has been slow in catching up, and whereas in schools we have legislation around fire extinguishers and smoke alarms, there isn't any legislation for defibrillators, and really the law is just trying to catch up with advances in medical technology. These weren't routinely available, say, 10 years ago.
Connor's family say today's landmark, defibrillator number 50, is just the start. The Connor Saunders Foundation wants to see one of these in every school and every sports centre. John Ryle, ITV News, Brighton.
In other news, a shop worker has been threatened with a pickaxe at a co-op store in Portsmouth. The man who covered his face with a grey scarf grabbed around £300 from the till during the robbery on London Road on Saturday.
A fire which destroyed a flat at Gunwharf Quays in Portsmouth started in the kitchen. 45 firefighters tackled the blaze on Saturday afternoon at the 10-storey block above Tesco Express. The shopping centre was evacuated for a time, but no one was injured.
15-year-old girl has been rescued after becoming trapped up to her knees in mud. It happened near Hyde Marina on Saturday afternoon. The girl was treated for a leg injury but didn't need hospital treatment.
Now, they spent 4 months on deployment in the heat of Iraq, but today it was a damp and drizzly Aldershot that saw a very special homecoming for the troops from the 4th Battalion, the Rifles.
Yes, with their proud families watching on, the Duchess of Cornwall was the guest of honour at Normandy Barracks. Rachel Hepworth was there for us.
A rousing military welcome on the wettest of Monday mornings. But the Duchess of Cornwall was undaunted by the weather as she inspected the troops dressed in the regimental colour, rifleman green. Her Royal Highness became the battalion's Royal Colonel 10 years ago, and she was here to welcome troops home from a four-month deployment to Iraq.
The fight against ISIS or Daesh is really in its closing stages in Iraq, as much as we can say. And so for us to go there and train the Iraqis so they can finish the work off there is really crucial. And so we hope that in the next few months, the situation will be far more stable there. So it's been really crucial and very timely intervention.
Hello.
But as well as those at the sharp end, the Duchess praised the families back home, calling them unsung heroes. Her support much appreciated.
She's just so supportive of the regiment, and she writes to us, and it was lovely to see her, particularly given the weather conditions.
She said happy birthday to me, and she just asked if we're glad to have Daniel home, and if we've missed him as well.
When a member of the royal family comes down and welcomes you back home, it just reminds you that actually you are representing the nation and your efforts are appreciated.
She asked me if I was cold.
And we lied and said no.
The Duchess, an army officer's daughter herself, was clearly at ease both with families and on the parade ground. The regiment demonstrating their traditional double march. Very handy for getting out of the rain. Rachel Hepworth, ITV News, in Aldershot.
More of the day's news now, and work to assess the damage to a car transporter after a fire on board has continued today. The American ship named Honour caught alight after leaving Southampton last Friday with 21 crew on board. The vessel's onboard systems, which put out the blaze, have now been replaced, and the ship remains anchored outside of Southampton.
The new Cowes floating bridge won't be in place until the end of next month, later than planned. The Isle of Wight Council today said it won't enter service until early May after staff training and trial runs. The previous floating bridge closed in January.
The I-360 tourist attraction in Brighton won't reopen until at least Wednesday. Passengers were left stranded for more than an hour when the viewing pod broke down on Friday. Its operators are blaming a damaged data cable and have apologised to any customers who are affected.
People are being urged to have their say on plans for a road tunnel past Stonehenge before a public consultation closes next Sunday. Campaigners fighting the plan say the 1.8-mile-long tunnel isn't long enough and fear it could blight the landscape. The preferred route will be announced later this year.
You're watching ITV News in the Meridian region. Thank you for choosing us. We really do appreciate it. Coming up in the programme. Back to Broadchurch, we take an exclusive look behind the scenes at West Bay in Dorset. What can we expect from the third and the final series?
And we'll meet Right Said Fred, celebrating 25 years. The brothers from Sussex drop in to see us with details of a very worthy cause.
They were fantastic fun. For more on all of our stories, head to itv.com/Meridian. Any views or any news, you can call us the number 0808 1010 095 or get in touch via Facebook or send us a tweet at ITV Meridian.
Well, the ITV Evening News continues with the national and the international news at 6:30. Let's now get a preview from Mary Nightingale in London.
The five-year-old who died hours after a GP refused to see her. Ellie May and her mother were late for her appointment. She was told to return the next morning, but she died just 5 hours later. The first victims give evidence to the troubled child sex abuse inquiry more than 2 years after it was set up. And
there's a mistake.
That jaw-dropping moment, the Oscars messed up. We examine exactly what went wrong. Do join me for those stories and more at 6:30.
Thanks, Mary. Now the sport from Andy Pate, back from Wembley, slightly long-faced.
Yeah, disappointed but proud. For Southampton supporters, it was a match that had a bit of everything, which included an heroic comeback and a late heartbreaking winner. But it was a day Saints fans can be proud of. Southampton's fans arrived at Wembley full of hope. But they knew for their team to lift the trophy, They'd have to get the better of world-renowned striker Zlatan Ibrahimovic and one of the game's most successful managers.
Mourinho is the special one, but only until 3 hours' time, and then he will realise the true special are the Saints.
Man United, they're on a great run at the minute and they're going to be tough to beat, but once that whistle goes, you know, I think all that will go out the window. It's a cup final, so it's anybody's, and hopefully it'll be the Saints that win it.
If they didn't have the Swedish player, or whatever he is.
Zlatan.
Ibrahimovic.
Yeah, that's his name. I would have said that we had a very good chance, and I still think we do have a good chance.
Afterwards, Jose Mourinho admitted Southampton were the better team in large parts, and they wrongly had a goal disallowed. Manolo Gabbiadini clearly onside. But then that man Ibrahimovic stepped up and curled in, United the lead. And Mourinho's men scored a second against the run of play through young England star Jesse Lingard. But red-hot Gabbiadini gave the Saints hope. This time, the goal stood and the Southampton fans roared their team off at half-time, which was nothing to the noise generated when Gabbiadini scored the equaliser. He's only played three matches for the team, and this was goal number five. The Saints pressed forward, and Oriol Romeo so nearly headed home, but it came back off the post. Did you think you'd scored?
I had no time to see it. So when I saw the ball, it was straight, already hitting the post. It was, you know, 1, 2, 3 inches that the ball may go in, may go out. It changes the game, it changes the final.
And then that man, Ibrahimovic, intervened again with just 3 minutes to go to break Southampton hearts. What do you say to the Saints supporters?
Big thank you for supporting us and give us big energy, because we feel bad that we didn't give them more pleasure. But still, I think we deserve much more from this game.
Yeah. Now, there are also important league matches this weekend, not least in the Championship, with Brighton taking on Reading. Chris Hughton's team are back on top after an impressive win. Tomorrow, they host Newcastle. It is, though, a tough time for Bournemouth, but Oxford and Portsmouth have really hit home. Chris Morn starts our roundup with the Seagulls.
I cannot believe he spent the whole match on the bench.
Are you ever going to get off the bench?
Selco, sponsoring ITV Meridian Sports Report.
Brighton took another step towards the Premier League as they hit Reading time and again on the counter-attack. The width of the post denied Sam Baldock from one classy strike, so he produced another. From Bruno's pass, he controlled and finished superbly. The closest Reading came was Danny Williams' header, but Shane Duffy cleared. A minute later, the Seagulls flew forward. Dale Stevens put Jamie Murphy through, and the Scot doubled Albion's advantage. While the Royals are left casting anxious glances over their shoulders in the race for the playoffs, Brighton are well set for Newcastle's arrival tomorrow. Anthony Knockhart wrapped up a comprehensive victory. In the Premier League, Bournemouth enjoyed a decent start at West Brom as Ryan Fraser was hauled down. Josh King put away the penalty. But these are worrying times for Eddie Howe's team. West Brom soon levelled through Craig Dawson's deflected shot. The Cherries suffered a fourth straight defeat and slipped back towards the relegation pack as keeper Artur Boric failed to deal with the corner and Gareth McCauley won it. Oxford United could still have a say in the League One playoff shake-up. After Rob Hall put them in front at Chesterfield, Conor McElhaney weighed in with the first hat-trick of his career. The U's are just 4 points off the playoff positions with games in hand. Swindon collected their first win in seven matches, beating Coventry. Nicky Adjose scored twice, and Jonathan Abika's header helped the Robins to a much-needed win. They're still 3 points adrift of safety. Gary Roberts opened the scoring as Portsmouth did their League Two promotion prospects a power of good with three late goals at Carlisle. Amin Linganzi smashed in the second, and Jack Watmore bagged his first senior goal. Automatic promotion is still a real possibility. The tale of a beauty and a beast as Crawley won at Wickham in League Two. Adebayo Akinfenwa, nicknamed the Beast, had given the hosts the lead. The Chairboys even scored the next, but Paris Cowan-Hall's header was at the wrong end. So Crawley level, and finally the game's moment of beauty. Josh Payne's match-winning free kick. Chris Maughan, ITV News.
And that is a busy weekend of sport wrapped up.
Andrew, many thanks.
Thank you.
Now, they're the brothers from East Grinstead in Sussex who took the music world by storm in the 90s and are recognised around the globe thanks to this.
I'm too sexy for my shirt. Too sexy for my shirt. So sexy it hurts. And I'm too sexy for Milan. Too sexy for Milan. New York and Japan.
It is 25, yes, 25 years since that song by Right Said Fred was released. Now there's a new album. Delighted to say they're here, brothers Richard and Fred Fairbrass. 25 years. Does it feel that long?
Longer.
Yes. Yeah. Actually not. No, it doesn't. No, it doesn't feel quite that long.
Your brothers, you get on well?
Pretty well, yeah. We've had a few fallings out. We had a bit of a... We actually got a little bit sort of fisticuffs with each other in Munich once, late night in a lift after a bit too much alcohol.
Yeah.
But that's about the only time. And if we do argue, it tends to come and go pretty quickly.
Yeah.
You've got a new song out, filmed in a pub in Berkshire with all the locals.
We have.
Let's have a quick listen.
Okay.
Brilliant. And it's all for charity.
Yes, the idea was that the budget was good because we're self-funding and independent. The video budget was getting a bit ridiculous. So we said we'd rather cut back to the original budget and just the remaining money left over we'd give to a charity. And we chose Crisis because I'd been homeless in the 80s. Well, I wasn't on the street, but I had to register as homeless. And also a good friend of ours works at Crisis. So it sort of...
So it made sense.
Yeah, it made sense. Yeah.
Your fans are incredibly loyal, and you've got them involved in a remake of your original hit.
Yes, we did.
Mm. Yes, we did.
It's part of a campaign on Pledge Music, which is like a crowdfunder.
Yeah. And to celebrate, at the time it was 25 years. So.
Yeah, it was just always nice. So people saying re-release it, and we didn't want to re-release it, but we wanted to give it a nod.
Let's have a listen, shall we?
Yeah.
Here we are. You've been going a long time.
Yes.
Not as long as the other Fred, me.
You've done pretty well for yourself, though. Don't be so modest. Yeah.
But your fans have been incredibly loyal, haven't they?
Yes, they have. We're very lucky. People are very sweet. We rarely get negative feedback. We're very, very blessed.
So
appreciate
what's next
it.
For you? Where are you performing?
We're at Camp Bestival.
Brilliant.
This
new
summer.
Venue. Lulworth.
Yes. Then we're at Cornbury, just Oxfordshire.
Yeah.
We're also in Kent at Ramsgate at the Music
Hall.
Ramsgate Music Hall.
So loads of opportunities.
Yeah, loads
of
little gigs, big festivals, just mixing it up. It's fun. Yeah.
Can you believe it's lasted so long and you're still so popular?
No, because I think we're very fortunate. Yeah. Very, very fortunate.
I'm amazed, frankly.
Yeah.
Staggered by the whole thing.
I think it's partly we have worked hard, but also you've got to put it down to luck as well. Yeah. I think you're naive if you imagine luck doesn't play a part. Yeah.
Very tiny part, though.
Guys, great to see you.
Pleasure.
Keep
nice
to see you too.
Keep up the great music.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Smashing.
Now, it's a fictional seaside town with as many murders as cafes, and tonight one of the biggest crime dramas returns to ITV. Broadchurch is back for its third and its final series.
Indeed, filmed at West Bay in Dorset, starring David Tennant and Olivia Colman, tonight we'll see the arrival of new faces, Lenny Henry and Sarah Parrish, who, of course, lives in Hampshire.
Well, Kylie Pentelow has been on location behind the scenes at West Bay.
Cameras set, lights on, actors ready. After months of filming, the third and final series of Broadchurch is hitting our screens. Complete, of course, with David Tennant and Olivia Colman, who I managed to chat to between takes.
Was there ever a point where you guys thought, I'm not going to do the third one?
No.
No, I don't think there was.
Nice job, well written, and they pay us.
I mean, the first one was a one-off. And then the idea came that we would do two more. So that was sort of, we kind of knew that if we did another one, we'd do two more. That was always the kind of plan, wasn't
right.
it?
Yes.
So, yeah, I mean, it felt like such a long way off when we agreed to that. And now here we are in the middle of halfway through the final series. It'll be very sad to say goodbye.
And what's this series like? How does it compare to the other two? Because the first two were quite different in feel.
There are many
feel,
more dance numbers
they?
In this one.
Lots of smiles.
Yeah.
Really happy.
It's interesting, isn't it? It's hard to know until you've seen it as well. Because of course, we don't get to see it. We certainly don't get to see anything finished for months and months.
And also, all we get are emails from lovely producers going, guys, it's brilliant.
Yeah.
But there'll never be a producer who goes, we're really worried.
We're stuck.
What's it concerning?
Ed.
It sounds her. Can you make it quick?
No. Can we talk in private?
Now, you're the new girl. What's that like?
It's always really odd coming into a series that has been going for a long time. There's a certain amount of pressure that you feel. Broadchurch is very, very successful. The actors in it are very, very good. So you think, you don't want to let people down.
Did you watch it?
I didn't.
Have you watched it now?
I've never seen it, no. And now I kind of then went, I'm not going to watch it because then maybe I'll jinx it. Do you know what I mean? I'm not going to watch it.
Yeah, and try and be a certain way.
Yeah, so I haven't seen it. I haven't watched it. I don't want to see any influence at all. But what I'm going to do is before this series comes out, I'm going to binge watch one and two.
Yeah.
And then go straight into three. So I'll literally Broadchurch
for 2 weeks.
Oh, my goodness.
You're going to love it.
I know.
It's really good.
I know. I've heard.
I think it's a different sort of story. And there's a lot of new characters in it. So We're investigating a crime sort of more than we have done previously, I think. You know, we're sort of meeting new people and finding out about them and investigating their lives, whereas before, of course, the story's been much more sort of part of our own psychology, I guess. Mm. So that gives it a different flavour, but it's still the same, still got the same tone, I suppose.
Does that mean that you two aren't so much the focus of this one, then?
So far, yeah.
It's something that's
happened to someone that wasn't a close friend to either of us.
Yes,
right.
So we're finding out about a lot of new people and trying to sniff around their lives.
We'd like to take you somewhere where we can talk. It's just a short drive away, is that all right?
But even while they're recording, the cast themselves are kept in the dark about the plot.
All got theories.
We have no idea.
And we keep putting them to Chris, the writer, and he's got a fantastic poker face.
Mm.
Just goes, oh.
Either that or he's taking our theories away and writing them into episode 8.
Yeah. Everyone assumed.
He takes all the credit. We're coming up with it, really.
Everyone would assume that you know, the big stars know what's going on. They're in on it.
It's kind of quite useful not to, though.
In real life, you wouldn't know, would you? So it's quite an interesting way to work. And also, it makes great conversation in the makeup truck in the morning.
I
who
bet.
Do you think's done it?
If you just suspect everyone's guilty all the time.
And we do.
Yeah.
We're terrible detectives.
We yeah.
Let's hope not. Their final case begins tonight. Kylie Pentelow, ITV News.
Oh, it looks a bit scary.
It does, very exciting. And Simon's got even more drama.
Yes, talk about drama. I mean, it's not got David Tennant and Olivia Colman in it.
No.
However, it all happened in Ron's back garden
not
in
Ron.
Sussex. Yeah, Ron's back garden. Have a look at this video.
Yeah.
And you can see that there's a badger.
Yes.
Just enjoying his tea.
Yes.
What could possibly go wrong? Well, that's what could go wrong. Look.
Oh.
Your fox comes, hungry fox, nabs it. We'll just take another look at that in fast motion. There we go.
Hey.
Cheekiest fox ever.
Did he get
brilliant footage. No, I don't think he did. I think he went hungry, that poor badger. But we've had some other pictures of creatures that are perhaps a little on the hungry side. Brilliant one here. Have a look at this. This is from Peter Merchant. He took this picture at the Warnham Nature Reserve in Sussex. That's a kingfisher enjoying a fish supper.
And here's an action shot, whilst we're having fish here, from Lorne Bissell. That's a great crested grebe.
Is it?
Enjoying a fly-through meal. Look, it's eating as it goes. That's got to lead to indigestion, that, hasn't it? That was at Longham Lakes in Dorset. How good is this from Penny Wade in Hythe, who spotted someone sharing lunch with a dear friend? Hey, see what I did there? And in other interesting animal news, Gemma Kemp came across a two-headed giraffe on a visit to Chessington. And finally, Abby Ramshaw wonders, is this a rhinoceros or a binoceros? But either way, two heads are better than one. But you can take a close look at all of those on my blog on our website, itv.com/meridian.
We've had a bit of storm, Ewan.
We have.
Yeah, a lot of rain.
Yeah.
You're going to stop it now?
No.
No, he's not going to stop it. We've got more to come. Let's find out with the worst, Simon Parkin.
From blizzards to pool. Driving through Europe, Eurotunnel the Shuttle sponsors ITV Meridian Weather.
Now, you can always tell when there's going to be some damp weather around because I always show a picture like this one. Gorgeous image of a very wet spider's web in Locks Heath from Andrew Gregory. And that sets the scene for a week when there'll be, well, a lot of unsettled weather. The remnants of Storm Ewan is just pushing itself away. But from the west, you can see there are further low pressure systems, more weather fronts coming through as we head through this week. And that means more rain at times and also some strong winds too. Certainly some quite hefty showers today. A few more heading through this evening. You can see from the white flecks, there could be a little something wintry over the higher ground of the Chilterns, the Cotswolds, the Downs, Salisbury Plain. Nothing that will cause too much trouble, but by the end of the night, when we're dry with clear skies and temperatures are down to around freezing, there could be some ice around on untreated surfaces. Also a widespread frost to wake up to tomorrow morning, but a decent start to the day. Dry and bright through much of the morning. However, you know, there are more showers coming and they're going to start to push in from the west as we head through the afternoon. Again, some of them likely to be on the heavy side, accompanied by very strong winds gusting at around 40, 45 miles an hour along the coast and around the Isle of Wight. And look at those disappointing temperatures, peaking at a lowly 6 or 7 degrees for some of us. That's way below average for this time of year. As for your high tide times, well, you can see in Poole around 20 past 10 in the morning, then 10:45 in the evening. Now, the showers will fizzle away through tomorrow evening, and then for Wednesday, another frosty start. Should be dry at first, but it will turn unsettled later on with more rain arriving.
Eurotunnel the Shuttle sponsors ITV Meridian Weather.
What a miserable forecast, isn't it?
I know, but he can do better.
He could do. He's going to do better tomorrow. Yeah. Now, in a moment, the ITV Evening News with Mary Nightingale.
Stacey's got our late news. It is quite late, but she's worth staying up for. But for now, from the team here at ITV Meridian, thanks for watching. Take care.
Good night.